was thinking that tonight I would read you to sleep. Tonight we're going to be reading the Scarlet Letter. Chapter 1, The Prison Door. A throng of bearded men in sad colored garments and gray steeple crowned hats, intermixed with women, some wearing hoods and other bareheaded, was assembled in front of a wooden edifice, the door of which was heavily timbered with oak and studded with iron spikes. The founders of a new colony, whatever utopia of human virtue and happiness they might originally project, have invariably recognized it among their earliest practical necessities to allot a portion of the virgin soil as a cemetery and another portion as the site of a prison. In accordance with this rule, it may safely be assumed that the forefathers of Boston had built the first prison house somewhere in the vicinity of Cornhill, almost as seasonably as they marked out the first burial ground on Isaac Johnson's lot and round about his grave, which subsequently became the nucleus of all the congregated sepulchres in the old churchyard of King's Chapel. Certain it is that some 15 or 20 years after the settlement of the town, the wooden jail was already marked with the weather stains and other indications of age, which gave a yet darker aspect to its beetle-browed and gloomy front. The rest on the ponderous ironwork of its oaken door looked more antique than anything else in the New World. Like all that pertains to crime, it seemed to never have known a youthful era before this ugly edifice, and between it and the wheel track of the street was a grass plot, much overgrown with burdock, pigweed, apple peru, and such unsightly vegetation, which evidently found something congenial in the soil that had so early borne the black flower of civilized society, a prison. But on one side of the portal, and rooted almost as the threshold, was a wild rose bush, covered in this month of June with its delicate gems, which might be imagined to offer their fragrance and fragile beauty to the prisoner as he went in, and to the condemned criminal as he came forth to his doom, in token that the deep heart of nature could pity and be kind. This rose bush, by strange chance, had been kept alive in history, but whatever it had merely survived out of the stern old wilderness, so long after the fall of the gigantic pines and oaks that originally overshadowed it, or whether, as there is a fair authority for believing, it had sprung up under the footsteps of the sainted Anne Hutchinson as she entered the prison door, we shall not take upon us to determine, finding it so directly on the threshold of our narrative, which is now about to issue from that inauspicious portal. We could hardly do otherwise than pluck one of its flowers and present it to the reader. It may serve, let us hope, to symbolize some sweet that may be found along the track, or relieve the darkening close of a tale of human frailty and sorrow. Chapter 2, The Marketplace. The grass plot before the jail, in prison lane on a certain summer morning, not less than 2 centuries ago, was accompanied by a pretty large number of the inhabitants of Boston, all with their eyes intently fastened on the iron clamped oaken door. Among any other population or a latter period in the history of New England, the grim rigidity that petrified the bearded physiognomies of these good people would have argued some awful business in hand. It could not have betokened nothing short of the anticipated execution of some noted culprit on whom the sentence of the legal tribunal had but confirmed the verdict of public sentiment. But in that early severity of the Puritan character, an interference of this kind could not so indubitably be drawn. It might be that a sluggish bond servant or an undutiful child whom his parents had given over to the civil authority was to be corrected at the whipping post. It might be that an antinomian, a Quaker, or other heterodox religionist was to be scourged out of the town, or an idle and vagrant Indian whom the white man's fire water had made righteous about the street was to be driven with stripes into the shadow of the forest. It might be too that a witch, like old Mistress Hiddens, the bitter tempered widow of the magistrate, was to die upon the gallows. In either case, there was pretty much of the same solemnity of demeanor on the part of the spectators, as befitted a people amongst whom religion and law were almost identical, and in whose character both were so thoroughly interfused that the mildest and the severest acts of public discipline were alike made venerable and awful. Meager indeed and cold was the sympathy that a transgressor might look for from such bystanders at the scaffold. On the other hand, a penalty which in our days would interfere would infer a degree of mocking infamy and ridicule might then be invested with almost as stern a dignity as the punishment of death itself. It was a circumstance to be noted on the summer morning when our story begins its course that the woman of whom there were several in the crowd appeared to take a peculiar interest in whatever penal infliction might be expected to ensue. The age had not so much refinement that any sense of impropriety restrained the wearers of petticoat and farthingale from stepping forth into the public ways and wedging their unsubstantial persons, if occasion were, into the throng nearest to the scaffold at an execution. Morally, as well as materially, there was a coarse fiber in those wives and maidens of old English birth and breeding than in their fair descendants, separated from them by a series of 6 or 7 generations. For throughout that chain of ancestry, every successive mother had transmitted to her child a fainter bloom, a more delicate and briefer beauty, and a slighter physical frame, if not a character of less force and solidity than her own. The women who were now standing about the prison door stood with less than a half a century of the period when the man like Elizabeth had been not there altogether unsuitable representative of the sex. They were her countrywomen, and the beef and ale of their native land, with the moral diet not a whit more refined, entered largely into their composition. The bright morning sun, therefore, shone on broad shoulders and well-developed busts, on a round and ruddy cheek that had ripened in the far-off island and had hardly yet grown paler or thinner in the atmosphere of New England. There was, moreover, a boldness and rotundity of speech among these matrons, as most of them seemed to be, that would startle us at the present day, whether in respect to its purport or its volume of tone. "Good wives," said a hard-featured dame of 50, "I'll tell ye a piece of my mind. It would be greatly for the public behoof if we women, being of mature age and church members in good repute, should have the handling of such malefactresses as this Hester Prime. What think ye, gossips, if the hussy stood up for the judgment before us five that are now here and not together? Would she come off with such a sentence as the worship magistrates have awarded? Mary, I trow not." "People say," said another, "that the Reverend Master Dimmesdale, her godly pastor, take it too grievously to heart that such a scandal should have come upon his congregation." "The magistrates are God-fearing gentlemen, but merciful overmuch, that is the truth," added a third autumnal matron. At the very least, they should have put the Hester. No, at the very least, they should have put the brand of a hot iron on Hester Pride's forehead. Madam Hester would have winced at that, I warrant me. But she, the naughty baggage, little will she care what they put upon the bodice of her gown. Why, look you, she may cover it with a brush or such a heathenish adornment, and so walk the streets as brave as ever. Ah, but, interposed more softly a young wife, holding a child by the hand, let her cover the mark as she will. The pang of it will be always in her heart. Why do we talk of marks and brands, whether on the bodice of her gown or the flesh on her forehead? Cried another female. The ugliest as well as the most bitter, pitiless of these self-constituted judges. This woman has brought shame upon us all, and ought to die. Is there not law for it? Truly there is, both in the scripture and the statute book. Then let the magistrates who made it of no effect think themselves if their own wives and daughters go astray. Mercy on us, good wife, exclaimed a man in the crowd. Is there no virtue in women, save what springs from a wholesome fear of the gallows? That is the hardest word yet. Hush now, gossips, for the lock is turning in the prison door, and here comes Mistress Pride herself. The door of the jail being flung open from within, there appeared in the first place, like a black shadow emerging into sunshine, the grim and grisly presence of the town beadle, with a sword by his side, and his staff of office in his hand. This personage's prefigured and represented in his aspect the whole dismissal severity of the puritanic code of law, which is what his business to administrator in his final and closest application to the offender. Stretching forth the official staff in his left hand, he laid his right upon the shoulder of a young woman, whom he thus drew forward, until on the threshold of the prison door she repelled him. By an action marked with natural dignity and force of character, and stepped into the open air, as if by her own free will, she bore in her arms a child, a baby of some 3 months old, who winked and turned aside its little face from the too vivid light of the day, because its existence heretofore had brought it acquainted only with the gray twilight of a dungeon or the darksome apartment of the prison. And I'm going to stop it there. Because I'm getting sleepy now myself. So, I hope you were able to find this relaxing. And maybe even boring enough that you just fell asleep. But I hope that you have a good night. And that you rest well.